Hello friends, this is Kunal sir again. So today we will deal with the other segment of modern physics, that is atomic physics. In this particular chapter, we will deal with few other subtopic. One is alpha particle scattering experiment, two, atomic spectra, three, Bohr model of hydrogen atom. Next, we will deal with the line spectra of hydrogen atom. And last one is de Broglie explanation of Bohr's quantization, right? So we will deal with these particular subtopics one by one. This chapter is carrying huge significance regarding the JEE examination, because we will get one sure shot question from this chapter and there will be straightforward question. So let's study. Before going into the alpha scattering experiment and Rutherford model directly, first we will see Thomson model. This is the first conceptual model of atom being provided long back, around 1898. So in the beginning of 20th century, this model was proposed. What was this model? Thomson suggested that within the atom, positive charges are uniformly distributed over it. That is very significant point. Remember, positive charges are distributed uniformly. So here, this reddish shade you are seeing is the distribution of the positive charges uniformly, and the negative charges, or the electron later will come to know, are ingrained in this in discrete fashion. So it is bit like these are the negative charges electrons, and they are looking like seeds on fruit. So that's why it is famously called plum pudding model. So what was his proposal? One point is this, that positive charges are uniformly distributed. So we will write positive charges are uniformly distributed, and the distribution of the negative charges are discrete. So these are the two points you need to remember: positive charge uniformly distributed, negative charge discrete distribution. Second most important point was, he suggested that at lowest energy state, the electrons are fixed on their own positions. So at lowest energy state, the electrons are fixed on their own positions. Second, he suggested that at excited state, the electrons will vibrate about their equilibrium positions. So I'm repeating again. First point is that at lowest energy state, they are fixed on their own positions. This is one. Second, at excited state, these electrons will vibrate. Like if this is the electron, it will vibrate about the equilibrium position. So after discussing the model, let us come to the limitation. What was the limitation? We have said that the electrons in excited state will vibrate about the equilibrium position. Now when they are vibrating, after seeing their vibration pattern, that it was vibrating with single frequency. That is the major problem. So if it vibrates with a single frequency, as per the classical theory of electromagnetic radiation, where it says that an accelerating charged particle will always emit electromagnetic radiation. So as per that, the electron will also emit radiation. That radiation will be reflected at spectra. But actually, in experiment, when the spectra was observed, it was seen that there are multiple spectra. So if there are multiple spectra, it means that it is associated with multiple frequency. But what this model is suggesting, that it is vibrating with single frequency. That means we should have a single spectrum. So these two ideas are interconflicting, hence this model was rejected. So after Thomson model, almost at a span of 10 to 12 years, in 1911, the second model came, is called Rutherford model. Interestingly, Rutherford happens to be the student of Thomson. Now, he carried out the alpha scattering experiment. What's that? Alpha particle was projected towards a heavy nucleus. This target nucleus, this is heavy. So from a very close by distance, the alpha particle flies away from it. The deviation is given by theta. This is the distance of closest approach B. B बी इज ऑल्सो नोन एज इंपैक्ट पैरामीटर. इट इज ऑल्सो नोन एज इंपैक्ट पैरामीटर. सो हियर यू कैन सी दैट दिस इज द डायरेक्शन ऑफ द फोर्स, द स्ट्रॉन्ग इलेक्ट्रोस्टैटिक रिपल्शन, एंड दिस इज द डायरेक्शन ऑफ मोमेंटम चेंज. सो करेस्पॉन्डिंग एंगल वी कैन फिगर आउट. द एंगल बिटवीन द फोर्स वेक्टर एंड डेल्टा पी वेक्टर इज फाइ. नाउ लेट अस चेक. सिंस द न्यूक्लियस इज वेरी हैवी, सो इट्स इनिशियल वेलोसिटी इज जीरो, फाइनल वेलोसिटी इज ऑल्सो इक्वल टू जीरो. दैट मीन्स बींग हैवी इट इज अनडिस्टर्ब बाई द मूवमेंट ऑफ अल्फा पार्टिकल. सो वेन द अल्फा पार्टिकल वॉज अप्रोचिंग इट, इट कैरीज अ मोमेंटम एम वी, मैग्निट्यूड ऑफ इट. इट फ्लाइज अवे फ्रॉम हियर एंड इट ऑल्सो कैरीज द सेम मोमेंटम, मैग्निट्यूड, डायरेक्शन चेंजेस. सो इफ आई कंप्लीट दिस, देन वी कैन सी दैट दिस इज द डायरेक्शन ऑफ डेल्टा पी, दिस इज द डायरेक्शन ऑफ डेल्टा पी. सो फ्रॉम द फिगर वी कैन इजिली फिगर आउट दैट दिस मोमेंटम चेंज डेल्टा पी विल बी इक्वल टू 2mv sine of theta by 2, right? Now let us see another thing. We know that impulse momentum equation, we can write the impulse as integration of f dt is equal to delta p. So now you see that this f and this delta p must be parallel to each other. Change in momentum takes place in the direction of the force applied. So I have to take the component of this f along this momentum. So this equation will be modified as f cos phi dt is equal to 2mv sine of theta by 2. Correct? Now let us see what is this f. This f is very simple. Electrostatic repulsion f is equal to, we can write ze into 2e. That is the charge of the alpha particle divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r square. Then we will have a change with this dt factor. You check initial angular momentum is equal to mv into b, mv into perpendicular distance b. That must be equal to I into omega. I will write m r square. Omega we will write d phi dt. So from there we can easily calculate the factor dt over here. So this integration I will change like f cos phi. We will write dt d phi into d phi. Now this dt d phi value can be calculated from here. So if I carry out this integration from lower limit, I will take minus pi minus theta by 2 to plus pi minus theta by 2. We will get a result cot theta by 2 is equal to 2 pi epsilon naught mv square by z square into b. So this is the outcome of Rutherford experiment to figure out the value of impact parameter. So after Rutherford's experiment, he came into these conclusions. One point, most of the places inside atom is vacant. Why? He saw that most of the alpha particles projected towards the nucleus were going undeviated. 1 out of 10,000 were directly coming back. Second, he suggested nucleus is very dense. That means most of the masses of an atom is concentrated in a small position, small core called a nucleus. Third, positive and electrically neutral charges, these particles are there at the core. Fourth point, negative charge particles were revolving around that core is called nucleus. Now, there are some limitations with this model too. We will discuss one by one. So let us discuss the first limitation. If I consider that the nucleus is here, so if atomic number is Z, charge here is Ze, then here is the electron revolving around it. I am considering this as R. So if I consider the electron is at rest, I have to check whether my conclusion is correct or not, my assumption is valid or not. See, if the electron is there, then automatically you will feel a force of attraction towards the nucleus. How much is the force? We know F equal to Ze into E divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R square. Now this force is inward force. If the electron has to be at rest, this force must be balanced some outward force. Now this outward force was not mentioned in Rutherford model. That means what? That means the electron cannot be at rest just because only one particular force is acting on it. So the electron will continuously move towards the nucleus. That is not possible because ultimately the atom will collapse. So that is the first limitation. Second limitation, we consider the same model. This is the nucleus. Here is the electron at r distance and it is revolving. So now I am considering that even if the electron revolves, even if it revolves, what happens? So here let us say we have velocity v. So if it is revolving in a circle, we know that in a circle there will be centripetal force. How much is that? Mass into normal acceleration. What is the value of normal or centripetal acceleration? It is v square by r. So it will be equal to mv square by r. And this force is supplied by Ze into E by 4 pi epsilon naught r square. So after seeing this, it seems absolutely fine. Okay, no problem. If it is revolving in a circle, then this particular electrostatic attraction is providing the centripetal force. Hence the electron is orbiting. There is no problem into it. But we have only considered one aspect of physics, that is mechanical aspect of Newtonian mechanics. We did not think about the propositions of classical electromagnetic theory. What it says? It says that when the electron is revolving, that means it has some acceleration, it will continuously radiate energy. So from where this radiation will come? This radiation of electron, from where will it come? It will come at the expense of mechanical energy. It will come at the expense of mechanical energy. So that means the energy of this electron reduces. So if it reduces, then the electron will spiral into the nucleus like this. So when the electron spirals into the nucleus, then stability of the atom is again in problem. So the second limitation we will discuss, that first case we have considered that the electron is at rest. Now we will consider that the electron is revolving around the nucleus. So if the electron is revolving around the nucleus, we can easily write that this electrostatic attraction is supplying the centripetal force mv square by r. So this situation seems to be absolutely fine. There is no problem whatsoever. But we considered only one aspect of physics, that is Newtonian physics. We forgot that there is another part called classical electromagnetic theory. What it says? It says that when the electron is orbiting, it is accelerating, means accelerating charge particle must radiate energy. Now from where this radiation will come from? If it radiates the energy from here, from where this radiation will come from? It cannot be generated automatically. This radiation comes from the mechanical energy. This comes from the mechanical energy. So that means what? That means the total mechanical energy of the electron reduces. So if the mechanical energy reduces, then the force of attraction will go on stronger and it will spiral into the nucleus. So when the electron spirals into the nucleus and falls over it, the stability of the atom is in question. Hence, it cannot be a stable standard model of atom. Next subtopic we will discuss is atomic spectra and Bohr model. Long before even Rutherford model was proposed, quite a few scientists, they were observing these atomic spectras and they were trying to come up with some formulas which can exactly denote the wavelength of emitted radiation, Like in 1885, Bomar came with an empirical formula. He suggested lambda is equal to 3646 into n square by n square minus 4 angstrom. Corresponding n values will be 2, 3, 4. Then around 1890, Rydberg, another scientist, he came with his own formula. He suggested 1 by lambda is equal to Rh into 1 by 2 square minus 1 by n square. But these are all empirical formulas. Empirical formulas means those are the formulas which were not having a strong theoretical foundation. Hence, they were not able to clearly justify the experimental result. So, after Bomar and Rydberg failed and Rutherford failed subsequently to give the standard view in 1913, just 2 years after Rutherford suggested his model, Bohr suggested one model and he gave few postulates. What is the first one? First one, he said that the electrons, while they are orbiting about the nucleus, they will orbit around the nucleus because of Coulomb's force of attraction, that is the electrostatic force, and they must obey all the laws of classical physics. Means these force must be balanced by the centripetal force, that is point number one. And point number two, total energy U will be equal to minus Z square divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r. We know any negative energy, this suggests that the orbits are stable. The second postulate was that as per the suggestion of the classical physics, that we can have n number of orbits, it goes to infinity. But here, as per the Bohr model, we will not have infinite number of orbits. We will have some specified orbits, and in those specified orbits, the orbital angular momentum L will be integral multiple of h by 2 pi. Means we can write L is equal to mv into r, that is the angular momentum, that is equal to nh by 2 pi, or in short we can write nh cut. H cut is Dirac constant, which is given by h by 2 pi. Here n is the principal quantum number. Now this condition that I have written over here, this condition is known as Bohr's quantum condition. This is known as Bohr's quantum condition. Now we will add on another discussion along with it. You check, the force was, F was Z square by 4 pi epsilon naught r square. So we can see here, magnitude of the force is 1 by r square proportional to inverse square law, and the direction of the force is along, this force is along plus minus r cap. Here in this case it is minus r cap, means radially inward. If these two conditions are made simultaneously, this particular force is called central force. This is called central force. F is called central force. So that means, in short, I can write this force as minus some constant C into r vector by r cube. From there, if I just do r cross F, dear student, you see r cross F will come minus C by r cube r cross r. Cross product between two similar vectors comes to be 0. So this will give the result 0. So that means r cross F, this is torque. So torque equal to 0, we know torque is nothing but rate of change of angular momentum. So it means angular momentum will be equal to constant. So what we should know, in Bohr orbit, angular momentum is quantized, and conserved. So if question comes in multiple option correct, that an electron is orbiting around the nucleus following the Bohr principle or Bohr's model, then angular momentum, orbital angular momentum is only quantized, only conserved, both A and B, none of them. Our answer should be both quantized and conserved. Here it comes, the most significant one. Bohr suggested ki although the electrons are revolving in the orbits and they are accelerating, but in those orbit means where the orbital angular momentum is conserved and quantized, in those orbits the electrons are not allowed to radiate any amount of energy. That means their total energy E, that is sum of kinetic energy plus potential energy, has to be constant. Next, he suggested that electromagnetic radiation can be radiated or absorbed only under one condition, if and only if, only one condition, that is if the electron discontinuously all of a sudden changes the orbit. If it goes from lower orbit to higher orbit, energy must be absorbed. If it comes down from higher orbit to lower orbit, energy will be radiated. So that is why the orbits are also referred as energy levels. So that I am saying, from higher orbit to lower orbit, radiation emitted; from lower orbit to higher orbit, energy absorbed. And this radiated or absorbed energy, Ei minus Ef, will be equal to h nu. H is Planck constant, and this particular condition is known as Bohr's frequency condition. Let us see, if we take this as the nucleus, nuclear charge Ze, here the electron is orbiting around it. We already seen that this is the F attraction. So how much F attraction we got? This is Ze square by 4 pi epsilon naught r square. This must be equal to mv square by r. 1 r cancels out. So r will be equal to Ze square by 4 pi epsilon naught mv square. This is equation number 1. We got another equation, that is angular momentum in Bohr orbit. L is equal to mvr, that is nh by 2 pi. From there, we can figure out v is equal to nh by 2 pi mr. If I substitute this value of v in this equation, it comes to be r is equal to Z square by 4 pi epsilon naught m into this factor square. So it will come n square h square divided by 4 pi square m square r square. Hence it will go up. So r equal to, we will get Z square into 4 pi square m square r square divided by 4 pi epsilon naught into m n square h square. Let us see, this is cancelled, 1 m is cancelled, 1 r is cancelled, anything else, 1 pi is also cancelled. So from there r is equal to, we are getting epsilon naught n square h square divided by pi square Z square, sorry, 1 pi is cancelled out there already. So we will get pi Z square. This is the value of R we will get. Now after substituting this value of R into this equation, if you see, so how much V will you obtain? V is equal to, you will get NH by 2 pi M into this value, that is epsilon naught n square h square divided by pi z square m. So from here let us see how much you are getting. NH cancelled, and we will get pi pi cancelled, m also cancelled. So v equal to, we are getting z square by 2 epsilon naught n h. So from these two equations, the most significant thing that we will have, radius of Bohr orbit is proportional to, you see, r naught into n square by z. This is the main takeaway, and from this equation you can write v is proportional to, I mean, we can put the equation sign over there, and here also if we put in equation, v is equal to velocity v naught in the first Bohr orbit into z by n.